Hello guys, this is your host Jose, and today I will be bringing you a new book, The Amber Room by Steve Berry. This is my first book in English, and I hope that you like it. Prologue: Mauthausen Concentration Camp, Austria, April 10th, 1945. The prisoners called him Ears because he was the only one of the Russians in Hut 8 who understood German. Nobody ever used his given name, Karol Boria. Shio, Ears, had been his label from the first day he entered the camp over a year ago. It was a tag he regarded with pride, a responsibility he took to heart. "What do you hear?" one of the prisoners whispered to him. He was cuddled close to the window, pressed against the frigid pane, his exhales faint as goose summer in the dry, sullen air. "Do they want more amusement?" another prisoner asked. "Two nights ago, the guards came for a Russian in Hut 8. He was an infantryman from Rostov, near the Black Sea, relatively new to the camp. His screams were heard all night, ending only after a burst of staccato gunfire. His bloodied body hung by the main gate the next morning for all to see." He glanced quickly away from the pane. "Quiet, the wind makes it difficult to hear." The lice-ridden bunks were three-tiered, each prisoner allocated less than 1 square meter of space. 100 pairs of sunken eyes stared back at him. All the men respected his command. None stared, their fear long ago absorbed into the horror of Mauthausen. He suddenly turned from the window. "They are coming." An instant later, the hut's door was flung open. The prisoners froze at the cold air coming in from the cold night outside. And inside entered Sergeant Hammer, the attendant for prisoners Hut 8. "Achtung!" Klaus Hammer was Schutzstaffel, SS. Tumor-armed SS stood behind him. All the guards in Mauthausen were SS. Hammer carried no weapons. He never did. A 6-foot frame and beefy limbs were all the protection he needed. "Volunteers are required," Homer said. "You, you, you, and you." Boria was the last selected. He wondered what was happening. Few prisoners died that night. The death chamber remained idle, the time used to flush the gas and wash the tiles for the next day's slaughter. The guards tended to stay in their barracks, huddled around iron stoves kept warm by firewood that prisoners died cutting. Likewise, the doctors and their attendants slept, readying themselves for another day of experiments in which inmates were used indiscriminately as lab animals. Hammer looked straight at Boria. "You understand me, don't you?" He said nothing, staring back into the guard's black eyes. A year of terror had taught him the value of silence. "Nothing to say?" Hammer asked in German. "Good. You need to understand with your mouth shut." Another guard brushed past with 4 wool overcoats draped across his outstretched arms. "Coats?" muttered one of the Russians. No prisoner wore a coat, a filthy burlap shirt and tattered pants. More rags than clothing were issued on arrival. At death they were stripped off to be reused, stinking and unwashed for the next arrival. The guard tossed the coats on the floor. Hammer point, "Mantel and Seichen." Boria reached down for one of the green bundles. "The sergeant says to put them on," he explained in Russian. The other three followed his lead. The wool chafed his skin, but it felt good. It had been a long time since he was last even remotely warm. "Outside," Hammer said. The three Russians looked at Borya and he motioned towards the door. They all walked into the night. Hammer led the file across the ice and snow towards the main grounds, a frigid wind howling between rows of low wooden huts. 80,000 people were crammed into the surrounding buildings, more than lived in Borya's entire home province in Belarus. He had come to think that he would never see that place again. Time had almost become irrelevant for him, but for his sanity, he tried to maintain some sense. It was late March. No, or was it early April? It was freezing anyways. Why couldn't he just die or be killed? Hundreds met that fate every day. Was his destiny to survive in this hell? But for what? At the main grounds, Hammer turned left and marched into an open expanse. More prisoners' huts stood on one side, the camp's kitchen, jail and infirmary lined the other. At the far end was the roller, a ton of steel dragged across the frozen earth each day. He hoped their task did not involve that unpleasant chore. Homer stopped before four tall stakes. 2 days ago, a detail was taken into the surrounding forest. Borya, one of the 10 prisoners chosen then, as well. They had felled 3 aspens, one prisoner breaking an arm in the effort and shot on the spot. The branches were sheared and the logs quartered, then dragged back to the camp and planted to the height of a man in the main grounds. But the stakes had remained bare the past couple of days. Now, 2 armed guards watched them. Arc lights burn overhead and fog the bitterly dry air. "Wait here," Hammer said. The sergeant pounded up a short set of stairs and entered the jail. Light spilled out in a yellow rectangle from the open door. A moment later, 4 naked men were led outside. Their blonde heads were not shaved like the rest of the Russians, Poles and Jews, who constituted the vast majority of the camp's prisoners. No weak muscles or slow movements either. No apathetic looks or eyes sunk deep in their sockets, or edema swelling emaciated frames. These men were stocky, soldiers, Germans. He had seen their look before. Granite faces, no emotion, stone, cold, like the night. The 4 walked straight and defiant, arms at their sides, none evidencing the unbearable cold their milky skin must have been experiencing. Homer followed them out of the jail and motioned to the stakes, over there. The 4 naked Germans' march were directed. Hammer approached and tossed 4 coils of rope in the snow, tied them to the stakes. Borya's 3 companions looked at him. He bent down and retrieved all 4 coils, handing them to the other 3 and telling them what to do. They each approached a naked German, the men standing at attention before the rough aspen logs. What violation must have they provoked to cause such madness? He wrapped the rough hemp around his man's chest and strapped his body to the wood. "Tight!" Homer yelled. He knotted a loop and pulled the coarse fiber hard across the German's bare chest. The man never winced. Homer looked away at the other 3. He took the opportunity to whisper in German, "What did you do?" No reply. He pulled the rope tight. "They don't even do this to us." "It is an honor to defy your captor," the German whispered. Yes, he thought, it was. Hammer turned back. Borya noted the last look. "Over there," Hammer said. He and the other 3 Russians trudged across fresh snow, out of the way. To keep the cold at bay, he stuffed his hands into his armpits and shifted from foot to foot. The coat felt wonderful. It was the first warmth he had known since being brought to the camp. It was then that his identity had been completely stripped away, replaced by a number, 10901, tattooed onto his right forearm. A triangle was stitched to the left breast of his tattered shirt. An R in his signified that he was Russian. Color was important too. Red for political prisoners, green for criminals, yellow, a star of David for Jews, black and brown for prisoners of war. Homer seemed to be waiting for something. Boria glanced to his left. More arc lights illuminated the parade ground all the way to the main gate. The road outside, leading to the quarry, faded into darkness. The command headquarters building, just beyond the fence, stood unlit. He watched as the main gate swung open and a solitary figure entered the camp. The man wore a green coat to his knees. Light trousers extended out the bottom to tan jack boots. A light-colored officer's hat covered his head. Outside thighs hitched bulked in a determined gait, the man's portly belly leading the way. The lights revealed a sharp nose and clear eyes, the features not unpleasant compared to other Germans, an instantly recognizable last commander of the Richthofen Squadron, commander of the German Air Force, speaker of the German Parliament, Prime Minister of Prussia, President of the Prussian State Council, Reichmaster of Forestry and Game, Chairman of the Reich Defense Council, Reich Marshal of the Greater German Reich, and the Führer's chosen successor, Hermann Göring. Boria had seen Göring once before, in 1939, Rome. Göring appeared then wearing a fleshy grey suit, his fleshy neck wrapped in a scarlet cravat. Robbie's had adorned his bulbous fingers, and a Nazi eagle studded with diamonds was pinned to the left navel. He had delivered a restrained speech urging Germany's place in the sun, asking, "Would you rather have guns or butter? Should you import lard or metal ore? Preparedness makes us powerful, butter merely makes us fat." Göring had finished that oratory in a flurry, promising Germany and Italy that they would march shoulder to shoulder in the coming struggle. He remembered listening intently and not being impressed. "Gentlemen, I trust you are comfortable," Göring said in a calm voice to the four Russian prisoners. No one replied. "What did he say, Shio?" whispered one of the Russians. "He's ridiculing them." "Shut up," Hammer muttered. "Give your attention or you will join them." Göring positioned himself directly before the four naked men. "I ask each of you again, anything to say?" Only the wimp replied. Göring inched close to one of the shivering Germans, the one Boria had bound to the stake. "Matthias, surely you don't want to die this way. You're a soldier, a loyal servant of the Führer." "The Führer has nothing to do with this," the German stammered, his body shimmering in violent quakes. "But everything we do is for his greater glory, which is why I choose to die." Göring shrugged, a casual gesture, as someone will do if deciding whether to have another pastry. He motioned to Hammer. The sergeant signaled two guards who toted a large barrel towards the bound men. Another guard approached with four ladles and tossed them into the snow. Hammer glared at the Russians. "Fill them with water and go stand by one of those men." He told the other three what to do, and four ladles were picked up, then submerged. "Spill nothing," Homer warned. Boria was careful, but the wind buffeted a few drops out. No one noticed. He returned to the German he had bound to the stake, the one called Matthias. Göring stood in the center, pulling off black leather gloves. "See, Matthias," Göring said, "I am removing my gloves so I can feel the cold, as your skin does." Borya stood close enough to see the heavy silver ring wrapping the third finger of the man's right hand, a clutched mailed fist embossed on it. Göring stuffed his right hand into a trouser pocket and removed a stone. It was golden, like honey. Borya recognized it, amber. Göring fingered the clump and said, "Water will be showered over you every 5 minutes until somebody tells me what I want to know or you die. Either is acceptable to me. But remember, whoever talks, lives. Then one of these miserable Russians will take your place. You can then have your coat back and pour water on him until he dies. Imagine what fun that will be. All you have to do is tell me what I want to know. Now, anything to say?" Silence. Göring nodded to Homer. "Giffe Eis," Homer said. "Pour it." Borya did, and the other three followed his lead. Water soaked into Matthias' blonde mane, then trickled down his face and chest. Shivers accompanied the stream. The German uttered not a sound, other than the chatter of his teeth. "Anything to say?" Göring asked. "Nothing." 5 minutes later, the process was repeated. 20 minutes later, after 4 more dowsings, hypothermia started setting in. Göring stood impassive and methodically massaged the amber. Just before another 5 minutes expired, he approached Matthias. "This is ridiculous. Tell me where das Bernstein Zimmer is hidden and stop your suffering. This is not worth dying for." The shivering German only stared back, his defiance admirable. Borya almost hated being Göring's accomplice in killing him. "Sei sin in los restik, die sin shine," Matthias managed in one breath. "You're a lying, thieving pig." Then the German spat. Göring reeled back, spittle splotching the front of his greatcoat. He released the buttons and shook the stain away, then coiled back the flaps, revealing a pearl grey uniform, heavy with decorations. "I am your Reich Marshal, second only to the Führer. No one wears this uniform but me. How dare you think you can soil it so easily? You will tell me what I want to know, Matthias, or you will freeze to death. Slowly, very slowly. It will not be pleasant." The German spat again, this time on the uniform. Göring stayed surprisingly calm. "Admirable, Matthias. Your loyalty is noted. But how much longer can you hold out? Look at you. Wouldn't you like to be warm? Pressing your body close to a big fire? Your skin wrapped in a cozy wool blanket?" Göring suddenly reached over and yanked Borya close to the bound German. Water splattered from the ladle onto the snow. "This coat will feel wonderful, would it not, Matthias? Are you going to allow this miserable Cossack to be warm while you freeze?" The German said nothing. Only shivered. Göring shoved Borya away. "How about a little taste of warmth, Matthias?" The Reich Marshal unzipped his trousers. Hot urine arced out, steaming on impact, leaving yellow streaks on bare skin that raced down to the snow. Göring shook his organ dry, then zipped his trousers. "Feel better, Matthias?" "Verrotten in der Schweinsoll," Borya agreed. "Rot in hell, pig." Göring rushed forward and backhanded the soldier hard across the face, his silver ring ripping open the cheek. Blood oozed out. "Pour!" Göring screamed. Borya returned to the barrel and refilled his ladle. The German named Matthias started shouting, Mein Führer, his voice grew louder. The other three bound men joined in. Water rained down. Göring stood and watched, now furiously fingering the amber. 2 hours later, Matthias died caked in ice. Within another hour, the remaining three Germans succumbed. No one mentioned anything about Das Verstehen Zimmer, the Amber Room.